So now that we've got tops and chops under our belt, the next thing we're going to take a look at are comps. And we're going to look at comps in two very simple examples. The first is using them to create different elements of UIs and little control panels. We won't be making a fully fledged UI, but at least we'll be making some kind of internal control that you can use. And the second thing is we're going to talk about how you can use something like a container to actually encapsulate some of the functionality of your networks and make them look a little bit cleaner so that they don't get out of control and messy. So with that said, let's delete everything here and start from scratch. So essentially what we are building is a visual representation of a bunch of noise data. Then we're going to create a couple of buttons and sliders that are going to give us controls over that visualization. So it's simple, and let's get started with what we know. The first thing I'm going to do is make some of the graphics. So I'll do tab to open the opcreate dialog. I'll go to chop, and then I'll create a noise by typing in noise and hitting enter. Now we're essentially going to be changing the different parameters of this noise with our UI elements. And then we're going to use a really cool operator to basically change all of those chop channels into pixel data that we can then display. So to do that, what we're going to do is first put a null after our noise. And then what we're going to do is, let's say in this case, we were actually building something more complicated. Like maybe for this example, it's not the perfect example, but it shows you what we can do with our encapsulation. So what I'm going to do is instead of putting all the operators that do the visualization on this level, I'm actually going to create a container, send my chop signal into it, you know, do any of the processing I want to do in there, and then output that signal and kind of make like a little black box tool for ourselves that converts chop channels into top data. So what I'm going to do is first make a container, and that's under the comps. And then I'm going to go inside of this container using the I key. I'm going to go to the chop family and I'm going to make an in chop. And essentially what this does is if I go back up a level with U, it'll put a little chop input onto my container. So that means I can then take this signal, connect it to the container. And then if I go inside of the container, I will see that data coming through. And we can see that this dotted little green line denotes that there is something plugged in to that container. Now, I could do all kinds of things in here, but we're going to do a really cheap trick that looks cool for a lot of different purposes. We're going to use what's called a chop to top. And it's chop to, but it's because of the top family, so it's named chop to top. So we're going to drop this in here. And what we're going to do is we're going to take our input data and we'll set it to the reference as the chop parameter of the chop to. And essentially what this does is it takes all the values from this that are ranging right now from -1 to 1, and it gives us the R data of the pixel. So in this case, it gives us a red channel, and because it's only a red channel, it basically ends up being 0 and below is black, and 0 and above, it becomes lighter and lighter until it becomes white. So as you can see, if we put this as our background and started to tweak some of the noise a little bit, we would see that change. But until we get there, what we should do is actually now we can output this from the container. So similar to how we made an in chop, now that we have a top and we want to get that data out of there, what we can do is make something called an out top. And the out top is basically the in chop, but for tops in reverse. So when I connect this chop to the out and I go back up a level, we'll see I now have a top output from that container. I can connect that to a null and then use the display flag to see it in the background. Now what I can do is if I go to my noise and I start to tweak parameters a little bit, we'll see that that visualization is changing. And there's lots of interesting things we can do even without going too deep into that. Now, one thing I did in the previous example that I showed you was that this right now, if I middle click on it, is 600 by 1, which is not ideal for displaying on screens or projectors or anything. So what I wanted to do was use a technique that we were trying to avoid before, which was basically putting this on a bigger canvas and stretching it. So one way I could do this is I can go back into my little black box tool here. And then before the output, after the chop to, I'm going to right click on the wire, hit insert operator, and I'm going to put something called a fit top. Fit top is very useful because if you want to put something onto a bigger canvas, this is another option. Before, we were kind of using a composite chains because they're a little bit simpler to understand. But fit top kind of rolls that functionality into one operator. So what I could do is right now I have a 600 by 1 pixel texture going into it. And let's say I go to the common page and I set it to be 1920 by 1080. Then I go back to the fit parameter, and instead of fit best, I set it to fill. All of a sudden, it's taking that one pixel line and basically just stretching it up and down and filling that 1920 by 1080 canvas. So now if I go back up a level, we'll see that what I had displayed from the null is that output. So we could almost by now get started by setting up our little UI, figuring out what kind of parameters we want to control, which ones look cool, which ones don't look cool, and we can work a little bit with this. So in the example that I made, what I did was I made a few buttons. So I'll go to the comp page. From the panel section, I'll pick out a button. I'll pick out another button. And then I made two sliders. Now what you'll notice is the reason why we looked at this little example first, even though it was very simple, is because you'll see that even though our buttons and sliders are comps, if we zoom in, we'll see they have a little chop output. And this is what I was mentioning earlier, where, you know, as we start to work with more and more different families of operators, knowing what the families do, and I think I mentioned that comps and UI elements, even though they're part of the comp family, the UI elements specifically, they actually give you chop data to use for your controls. So what I could do in this case is I'd make a null chop outside of my little button, and I'd connect it to my null. And then if I go and activate the viewer for these comps, I have a little button that I can turn on and off, and it gives me a 0 to 1 value. So now I can do similar. I'll just copy and paste that null, connect my next button, copy and paste that, connect my slider to it. And you can see slider is very similar, but it gives me a 0 to 1 value. And you can see we have a little indicator of where it is. So I'll do the same thing for my final slider. And then we could begin working. Now, let's go to our noise and let's start playing around with the different things we can control. So the first thing maybe we want to control is this exponent. It seems to make the effect kind of more intense, where it pushes everything into extremes of either on or off, or it takes things and makes them a bit more gradient. So you can see there's more subtlety to it. So that seems like a cool control that we can take advantage of. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to check what values I may want to set this to. So it seems like going from 0 to 2 is an interesting range for this. So I'll go and let's say I'll take one of my sliders. I'll just move these apart slightly. And I'll take the wire, right click on it, insert, and I'll put a math chop in between these two. Because like we said, my slider goes from 0 to 1. I want my parameter to go from 0 to 2. So I'm gonna use a math, just like we did before, to rearrange my value. So I know it goes from 0 to 1, and I want the output range to be 0 to 2. So now you can see my slider gives me a 0 to 2 value, and I can go to my noise, open its parameters, turn on the viewer active state for my null, and drag and drop that onto the exponent. Then I'll click the second option, relative chop reference, and we can see we have an easy little slider that controls that. So whether you want to use that in a UI that may be, you know, facing for the display or the performance or for a client, or you can even just use it internally as your own little control panel for testing different things. Now, one thing I had in my example was I actually had this noise being animated. So what I'm going to do is first make an LFO before we keep going with our little comp selection here. So I'll make an LFO chop, which is a low frequency oscillator. And what that does is it generates little signals that we can use to control things in simple shapes. So for example, this is a sine wave. We can make it a triangle wave. We can make it a ramp that just goes from 0 to 1 and kind of repeats. We can make it a square, so it just kind of bounces back and forth between -1 and 1. We'll just leave it on sine wave for now just to make it simple. I'm going to put a null chop after it. And then again, I'm going to go to my noise, open its parameters. And in this case, I'm going to go to the transform page, open the viewer on my null here, and drag and drop this to the rotate, and I'm going to go to the Z parameter. And basically what this is going to do is it's going to rotate the noise, which you don't have to worry about too much what that means, but it's essentially just going to animate and update those noise values in an interesting way. Now what we can see is this is completely crazy and out of control. So I'm actually going to go to my LFO and I'm going to turn down the frequency, and you can see if I set that frequency to zero, my animation stops. So I'm going to use the value ladder just to nudge this up by 0.01. And you can see it's still crazy, but it's definitely a lot less crazy, and it feels a little bit more interesting and understandable now. So with that said, what happens if I take my slider and I can change the exponent that we had set previously? And even just with a few operators, we're already starting to get some interesting effects. Maybe you're trying to make some glitch kind of effects for VJing, or maybe just for a more abstract art piece. I mean, with just a few operators, we're already starting to make some interesting stuff here, and we have controls. So let's map a few other parameters of our noise. I think a good example would be changing the noise type. Right now it's set to sparse, but another cool one is harmonic summation, which gives us a bit more flashing and kind of cool looks behind it. So what I'll use for this one is a button, because in this type, a slider probably wouldn't be appropriate, and I kind of just want to jump from sparse to harmonic. And one thing you'll see is if you click on any of the parameters' names, it'll open a little dropdown where it gives you a lowercase name, which we call the scripting name, but it also shows you value. And for a lot of these dropdown values, they're actually just indexes, they're indices. So they're numbers that control which option are being selected. So you can see here, sparse is option 0, and harmonic summation is option 2. So I could take my button and just change my value scale from 0 to 1 to 0 to 2. So I'll drag my null out a little bit here, insert a math in between, change the range from 0 to 1. The 2 range is going to be 0 to 2. Then I'll go to my noise, and just like we did before, activate the viewer on my chop, drag and drop onto the parameter, relative chop reference, and now I have a really easy way to change between one noise that's a little bit more active and exciting and another noise that is a little bit more subtle and kind of more, yeah, subtle is a good word for it. That's what it is. So what else can we control now? Let me set a few of these other parameters. Roughness could be one. What about amplitude? Amplitude is interesting. It kind of gives it more intensity and less intensity. Harmonic period is not as interesting, so I can just right click on that one and just reset it back to what it was. What we can do is actually add a little bit of post-processing. So in the example I made, I added something called an edge top. So I'll go right click on the parameter, on the wire that is, add an edge. And what this does is it does an edge detection for the lines, and it just gives them a little bit more body and interest. But what I did also is I animated this black level. So you can see by animating that black level, our lines, you know, we can even pause this and take a look. They're not perfect straight lines anymore. You can see there's a little bit of tapering, which adds, in my opinion, quite a bit of interesting look to this effect. So, you know, we can change the different types of noise, you know, whether we want it to be more sparse or more active. Having that edge top, I think, adds quite a bit of difference to it, where we can have something that's a little bit more static and kind of blocky, or we can get to something that has a little bit more shape and taper to it. That seems like a cool thing to do. So what I'll do is I'll connect my other button to this, because maybe I don't want to actually get any of these middle values. Maybe I just want to transition from this blockier mode to this more subtle and kind of tapered mode. So what I could do is I could connect my button, and what I'll do is I'll activate the viewer here, drag and drop my black level, relative chop reference. Now what you can see is this is going from 0 to 1, so as always, like I said, math chop is going to become a really good friend of yours. We're going to rescale that value so that it's from 0 to, I think 0.75 looked pretty cool. But then I don't want that to be instant, so maybe what I'll do instead is after my math, I'll insert another operator, which is called a filter. And filter is a really nice operator to become familiar with because it's similar to lag when you don't need to have a difference between the upwards momentum and the downwards momentum. So in this case, if I set my filter width here to 3 seconds, what it will do is it'll take 3 seconds to go from my original value to the new value. So you could make a nice little transition between these two different states. Now, the final thing is we have one more slider here. So what I'll do is I'll go to my noise. And I think what would be a nice one is maybe changing the roughness. So I'll take my null value again, click and drag it onto the roughness, relative chop reference, and then we can see how much we want to scale it. I think maybe we should go a little bit more extreme on the roughness and see what we can get. So I'll put a math chop in between here. And I'll change the two range to be from 0 to maybe 3. And we can see that gives us an interesting look. And we have a bunch of different kind of effects we can go through, really simply using our kind of like container-based system. Now, the key things you should take away from this are that your main uses for comps, at least when you're getting started, are going to be making quick little panels with buttons and sliders, making little mini networks using containers where you can kind of contain different elements of your network so it doesn't become too busy. And really, there's not much more to it than that for a beginner. If you start to build more complicated user interfaces, it gets a little bit deeper. I'd suggest checking out our user interface training. But there's not that many options on a lot of these sliders. I wouldn't recommend changing too many of the slider options. If you're using buttons, you can change between toggles and momentaries, whereas a momentary kind of just pulses the value instead of staying clicked down like a toggle would. But if you're getting into more of those complex usages, you should probably go check out a full-on UI training because there is a little bit of trickiness behind using these comps. So, end of the day, the takeaway, put things inside of containers to make your network clean, and you can make really easy control panels with buttons, sliders, and whatever else you want, and get those chop channels and map them correctly.